Welcome to Die Tryin'.
We need more power.
I'm Patrick Norton.
I'm Michael Land.
And it's kind of weird because overclocking is back. Actually,
I don't think it ever went away.
No, overclocking might be more useful. Okay, well, let me get to a point. I swear I have a point.
Okay.
This is another Haswell-E powered system. It's a 5820K.
Yeah, this isn't the one we built 2 weeks ago. This is a new one that is also very amazing.
People keep wandering into our cubes going, will you build this for us? We go,
boxes of parts.
Boxes of parts. And it's kind of a visceral thrill to handle somebody else's $2,500 pile of parts.
Yeah.
So we build systems, but this time we decided to overclock it because we were curious.
So for overclocking, you're making stuff go faster than it originally came to you. but does it actually do anything in real world performance?
So the GTX 970 we put into this case actually came overclocked from the factory, and GPUs have been doing pretty good with overclocking in terms of performance boosts. But CPUs, for me a few years ago, I kind of walked away from overclocking them because I would do a lot of work to overclock the part and I would see no particularly useful real world results.
But now with Haswell-E, it seems like it might be worth it.
Well, okay, so like the 5930K is like a 3.7 gigahertz in turbo mode from the factory. People are up in the voltage. Basically, they have to go into manual on that 5930K part, usually up the voltage around like 1.25 volts, 1.25 volts, and they're getting it up to like 4.5 gigahertz.
Cool. Does it make things go faster in the real world?
And that's actually a really good question.
So we decided to actually give it a go because now it's really, really easy to overclock. There's a couple of ways. Some manufacturers have Windows software that does it for you. You can always go into the BIOS, or some even have little switches that you can do and it's just auto overclocked for you.
But I don't know how auto overclocked it is, but at least, like, I mean, I gotta say my favorite button inside of here is the one that resets the CMOS if you screw things up.
But if you wanna actually get into the settings, then you can go through the BIOS and you can dig in. But we didn't actually dig in that deep, but we did get performance.
So we went inside the Easy Tuning Wizard. We basically ran the Easy Tuning Wizard. We have water cooling. We're gonna be doing video game stuff. We were super awesome and we restarted and it wasn't overclocked. And that's because we actually had to go from the Easy Tuning Wizard into the AI tweaker and set it to auto. When we rebooted at that point, things were pretty cool. It was running at 4.1 gigahertz or 4,100 megahertz.
Mm-hmm.
And then you went in and reset the core ratio limit.
Yeah, that's what I did on my Sandy Bridge chip at home. I think that's like the top end of the turbo boost. So that's like when things are getting maxed out, that's like the upper limit. And
lo and behold,
we got to 4,500 megahertz and then we started doing some tests.
But before we reveal to you the secret results of our benchmarking of our overclocked machine, we should tell you about domain.com. They're our sponsor of this episode of Die Tryin'.
Yes, they are. And don't they host some of your websites?
I actually just bought 4 new domains with domain.com and I used the coupon code TechZilla.
Even though this is Die Tryin', TechZilla gets you 20% off your order.
Domain.com and the coupon code TechZilla. Thank you for your support. So the Core i7 5820K's turbo frequency in the stock settings is 3.6 gigahertz.
Yes.
We're now running it at 4.5 gigahertz maxed out in turbo mode.
So almost a full gigahertz of extra performance. So what does that do to our results? So I did some tests before we overclocked on video encoding. Mm-hmm. So I took a 4K video, encoded it in Adobe Media Encoder and in Handbrake.
You edit a video, you massage a video, you put effects in a video, you tweak a video, you create graphics for the video, and then basically you hit the magic button, and the magic button renders the video out. And the longer it takes to render the video, the longer you have to wait before you get to start editing your next video and making more money. So literally, time is money, and how much money or time did we save?
We saved about 25% of monies. Encoding a 4K video in Media Encoder, it was about 26% faster, and Handbrake 24%. So really impressive considering we just clicked a few buttons.
We also ran Cinebench and 3D Mark Firestrike. Cinebench is primarily a CPU test, and the overclocked version of the system was 30% faster. That's pretty epic. 3D Mark Firestrike, not nearly as impressive. It's primarily a test of graphics. And we were looking at a 2% increase in the overclocked version. So generally speaking, in gaming, don't expect a huge increase from overclocking unless your game is particularly CPU bound. And in case you're wondering, yes, we have actually been running like Prime 95 and some other basically hardcore thrash the system by maxing out the thermals on the parts and the GPU and FuMark and Prime 95, and everything has been running stable at the overclock. So. Yes.
Water cooling, Haswell-E,
Magic.
Magic. $2,500 worth of magic, or if you build the system we built for another editor a couple weeks ago, $2,900 worth of magic, but magic.
Magic.
Speaking of magic, how about turning your own urine into an electrical battery?
That was so long ago, but it is kind of magic. You get some charcoal and then you need some salt water.
Don't just watch the video.
Yeah.
I'm Patrick Norton.
I'm Mike Land.
We'll see you next time on Die Tryin. Please subscribe. Tweet at Die Tryin. Watch out behind you. Behind you.